Taxomike, thank you very much, and I hope that everyone understands now Spanglish or something. I am going to talk about some examples from here, from this house, and also not only from the exhibitions, but also from the management of collections. This museum opened in 2004 for the community here, and it was a political project organized by the social democracy. And at that moment, we got the director, Jette Sandal, and she came from a large movement of, at first, feminism, and also decolonizing practices. She was one of the founders of the Women Museum in Aarhus, in Denmark. Until that moment, all the collections that we have here had been presented as a traditional ethnography. This is a national institution. We are part of the Swedish government. And at the same time, from the creation until today, we have been trying to implement post-colonial, in the beginning, was called. After with Jette, we start to talk and use more the decolonial term, especially because we were very influenced by Latin American philosophers. If we see the collections that we have here, 75% of the collections are Latin American. At that moment, in the opening exhibitions, we were working a lot of in trying to incorporate especially other voices, other histories, and to try to multiply the possibilities of the collections. One of the first exhibitions was called the Sister of Dreams, Drömmen Sister in Swedish. And there, as Julia presented before, here the idea was to deconstruct and to rethink and reflect about especially landscape and the idea of time, to try to change the idea of a Western world, idea of landscape and time, especially. This exhibition was especially for children. So we use also, at that moment, we were talking a lot of about incorporate emotions, and it was something very, very new for us that we came from the ethnographic museum. It was a process that I can tell you now, it was very painful. The change of all this tradition going from ethnography to this new paradigm was completely painful for many of us. At that moment also was invited Fred Wilson, that was named before. And with Fred Wilson, so the idea, I had the opportunity to work with him during a long time. And there, the idea was to try to decode the collections and to try to go beyond the colonial information and the colonial labeling of the collections, especially. For me, it was an interesting process because, as archaeologist that I have been training in Argentina, to come and work with him, and especially because he chose some of these urns that I had been excavating before when I was a student in Argentina. And there also, it was to try to decode the scientific information that, when this material was excavated, was very involved in a colonial way of interpreting the archaeological and historical material from other people around the world. He took these urns, and if you can see, so they are crossed there, and when they were found in the field, they were complete, but they were crossed so they could be easy to transport to Sweden. And he chose them and told the history, but also he make a parallel between these objects and immigrants, people that needed to move from one country to another, and you can be crows during the process. And everyone can see you as a complete piece, but you are not complete. You have an history of being broken during the process. At that moment also, in this idea of decoding the collections and decoding the process of making exhibitions, trying to leave this static idea of ethnography. So we start to talk about decolonial practices. We have never been defined it inside our practice, but it was more to incorporate multiple voices, other curators. The first exhibitions we had here, we had the possibility to have curators from Africa, Latin America, people living here from Africa's Horn, people that could talk about, for example, emotions, etc. Not only artists, but people that were involved. Also the staff of the museum at that moment, almost 30-35% of the staff had another background in Swedish, middle-aged, middle class, etc., that probably we are today. We have come back probably more to the period before 2004. I can show quickly how the collections are labeled. And if you can see, for example, we have still the process that in the collections management, that the collections are divided in geographic continents, and they are divided also in archaeology and ethnography. And for example, we have nothing like history or art or other categories. And if you take the Americas, that is the area that I know best, archaeology is everything before Columbus. And after Columbus is ethnography. And why not history? Because we have nothing from the hegemonic groups. You have nothing from the high class in Buenos Aires or in Mexico City. It's all about people that had been excluded from the national projects when the national state in Latin America were constructed. So everything is ethnography, are those that are excluded. And at that moment in 2004, when we start to talk about everything, so many of us in the staff and many people that had been working here for many, many years, so they didn't true that the collections has a colonial history. I had the possibility to work with all the Latin American material at that moment, and we could see very quickly that, yeah, there is the colonial. You don't need to have colonies in other countries to be part of the colonial project or the modernity project. And it's because it was so important to work with this decoding in some way. At that moment, from 2004 until 2006-07, we had a lot of, we could improve and make a lot of tests and experiences in the exhibitions. But the management of collection still was incredibly traditional, and it was almost impossible to change inside our way of working until we make an exhibition about trafficking of people. And there, I personally became involved in collecting this boat. This is a typical boat that people come from Northern Africa to Europe every day. You have been listening or reading in the newspapers. So I was involved in this, and I had a collaboration with Médecins Sans Frontières and with the Spanish police and with European police here. And there we could see, we were working there. There we could see, this is our collections are registered here. I don't know if you can see, I tried to make bigger, but there you can see that, for example, all the information that we have of the objects, we have a huge amount of information about every object, but when you present to the public, we usually clean everything that is painful, everything that can be offended, and at the end, in our way of showing the collections or registering the collections, we try to, in this cleaning, It's an interesting way also about creating amnesia in some way. And for example, this boat that you could see, this patera, so it's only a boat in the register. It's not anymore a patera. And if you use the word patera in Spanish, it means all this trafficking. It means all the asymmetry. It means what is going on today. There, with this word, with patera, so you have the power of an icon. But if you say it's a boat, it's a simple boat. And there we could see that, okay, something that we need to do here is to see why and how this gap between what we say and what we do has been created. It's like we can say something, but our body still working in the old-fashioned way. We come to the stores or we come to our job and we do things exactly as we have been training. And there was interesting because it's something that Jette at that moment pointed out, also Fred Wilson, that it's so interesting that decolonizing, it's always the colonized's problem, not the colonizer. It was our as colonized. I include myself as Latin America, a Latin American in this concept. So it's our work to show how the colonial power has been working. At that moment, we got some money. We could make a project called The State of Things to see over our practices. We took four collections, one from Congo, from the Sami, from Mapuches in southern Chile, and from Australia. We invite four curators from every part of these places. And the idea was not that they are going to see the collections. The idea was that they could reflect over how we work. They should be some kind of guides for us to improve our practices and to show us when we are making those mistakes that we know intellectually, but we cannot change in our body. We choose some objects that they are religious, like this Machi Pole from the Mapuche area, and a Saite from the Sami area. And for example, something that the Sami curator asked was to make an offer of fat on the stone. And she needed to update the Saite from when it was collected 400 years ago until now. 400 years ago, it was only men that could offer to the Saite, but today it's allowed also for women in the Sami area to offer. So we had a long meeting that day at the stores. We were all the conservators, curators, photographers, and we decided to do this, to put fat on this. And she invited the Mapuche curator, and they do it together. And they learn us how to do this. It was a long project, so if you have questions, you can send me an email in the future. I have been thinking to use Grossfogel and about his idea of how he has been discussing human rights, because I think that if you take away human rights and put national institutions, you could have almost the same paradox. It's very difficult. I don't think that it's possible to make many changes inside national institutions. You must to work against all the politicians, the state, and the letters that we get every year. Thank you.
See, there we are.
Yes.
So, Adriana saved some more time for questions. So, we have the mic coming.
Hi,
Thanks very much, that was brilliant. You said that a few years ago the staff were 35% not white, not middle class, and then it changed. Why did it change?
At that moment, it became also elections in the country, and the right-wing party, they win, they call Moderatas, and all the process inside the museum changed. The director at that moment, she couldn't still be the director, came a new director, and a new process inside the practices. For example, we got more that we show more objects, but also to be more, in some way, in entertainment, and not to talk so tough. So we try to do things here, improving things, but it was a long process. It's a political process. All the society has changed a lot of here since 2004 until today. You have an other political agenda and how the Congress or the government here is represented. You have almost, I don't know now the numbers, but for example the Swedish Democrats, that they are almost very conservative, I don't know, they are the third party in the country.
Thank you for your presentation. I actually have the same question.
Okay.
So you helped me with that one. But is it possible to just make this mic more soft in some way? Yeah? I'm just hearing myself so loud. But I know that you also are quite aware of your heritage is also taken by violence from other countries in the world. And I wanted to know if you have, or how your work is going on to actually returning the objects.
It's a real complicated situation because all the questions about repatriation are between states. So if somebody is asking for repatriation, it's not coming to us directly, but to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And it's something in between countries, states. In some cases, when, for example, in the beginning of when we became Museum of World Culture, and we could see that there is a moral question, so we could make depositions in the other countries. But now, for example, we have this well-known Paracas. There are textiles from here that they are coming back to Peru, but they are not part of the Swedish national institution. They are part of the city, so it's Gothenburg which is repatriating this. The Swedish government said that if it's about human remains, they must send back. But otherwise, it's a problem between law and moral, and there you have no law. It's about, probably tomorrow, Stefan is going to talk more about this in his study case.
Yeah, so the decisions are not for the museums. We can make a preparation, and then it's up to the politicians to decide. And of course, it's in any country, most people are quite reluctant, because if repatriation starts, then it's a lot of questions that will be raised, and a lot of money that has to be spent. So, yeah. So we have another question here.
Thanks, Adriana. My question relates to the issue you raised of cleansing.
Of
historiographic cleansing processes. I'm curious to know about that in two manners. Firstly, where is the demand for the cleansing of these objects coming from? And then secondly, what are the processes of implementation by which it happens? So who says the objects need to be cleansed for public appetite? And secondly, what are the actual processes of this cleansing?
Um, It depends so much about the cases.
If you can do it by example, then that would be great.
I try to try to find.
I mean, it could also be. So the catalog is very old. It's written when things come into the collection. So yeah. There's one problem is of language, that the language that was used to describe things is not compatible to how we speak about things today. It would be very demeaning. So then you can't use what is in the catalog, and if we display that today, it sounds as if the museum today is speaking with those words. So then that information might be lost. Or so that's in a way a positive cleansing, you might say. I mean, there is all
at the same time, we have the problem that we always come there. It's because it's difficult to find a good example just now. Because, for example, it's big differences between the beginning and today. When we had more resources and we could invite a lot of people to work together. So it was much easier to understand what we have. But today, for example, many times we have not enough knowledge. And this is probably a big problem. We don't know so much. And it's because it's difficult sometimes to. We need to use what we have and try to decode ourselves without knowing so much.
Thank you.
So we take one last question before coffee breaks and more informal questionings.
Thank you so much for your presentation. Continue on from that question. Would you say also that the general drive in the cultural heritage sector to digitize for Creative Commons is also revealing the cracks, the problems, the amnesia in the original cataloging processes, also in terms of how artifacts were produced in the first instance? I've spent some time with Carlotta and Pingula, I think it's called, the other digital online database, and some of the photographs from Congo, for example, missionary, there's like zero metadata.
Yeah.
I mean, not even a sense of cultural context. So often you'll be confronted with very specific expressions of culture, like a cosmogram or scarification, and the catalogue tells you nothing. Now, there is a process between the old paper catalogue and the new digitization process, but it's like nobody wants to insert themselves into that data to give us a story beyond the fact that it's got on paper and different dimensions. Can you speak a bit about that process?
Yeah, this is a very personal experience now. It's not an institution opinion. I have been working with the catalog for many, many years, with the archive, and it was one of the big paradox that we have. If you ask me personally what I think about this in our practice working with this, it's that we are working to create amnesia. This is almost our job. And we are an institution working for memory. But because the objects, this is a little complicated. I don't know if I can explain myself so well in English, but if you say that, if you can see that these objects have been changed home is anymore the same home. You have a huge change in, not only in the cultural context, but you have also a philosophical, cosmological change. And when you take there, if you take, I don't know nothing about Congo, but for example, if you see the Latin American objects, all the description about them that you can have, it's always under this scientific paradigm that it's telling nothing. It's telling something, but it's not telling, it's only one part, but not, And when you are going to present these objects, usually it's the only thing that you have. So when I'm presenting in an exhibition, I am reproducing the amnesia, I am reproducing, and this is really a self-reflection. I have any solution. The solution is to have resources, to have curators that have the emotional connection and the cultural background and the cosmological idea about these objects. And until now, I have never seen a budget that include those possibilities. But this is, as I tell you, this is my own reflection, working daily and feeling like a very frustrated Sisyphus in some way.
Yes. So if I get, I mean, there is nothing lost in the digitalization process here, because we take, but there is nothing to lose. And as Adriana said, I mean, there has been special state money to digitize, but not to create any information about what is digitized. So in that respect, of course, it's a political decision to, that is more important than this other work that is much more time consuming and so on. But, so, we are 1 minute before coffee, and we need a minute to reach the coffee. I think it's where we had lunch. Yes, so thank you for the first panel. Thank you very much.